Okay, good evening again. I would like to start my topic of bone disease in dialysis. I concentrate only on CKD5D and bone disease. The content of the talk would be a basic introduction and what's the type of bone disease in CKD and what are the recent KDIGO guidelines. And I will touch upon few ERADTA presentations which happened in June, which may be relevant in the present context. And summary. Basically, CKD characterized by progressive disruption of various metabolic parameters, including phosphorus, calcium, and various hormones, of which PTH we are all more concerned in this topic. Bones, as we all know, is of two types: cortical bone and cancerous bone. And cancerous bone. Normally, for bone remodeling, we need both osteoclasts, which help in absorption, and osteoblasts, which are helpful in forming new bone. Osteocytes, which are the predominant bone, which helps us to keep the bone viable for various years, with equal quantity of osteoblasts and osteoblasts. I won't go into the details of bone remodeling. Osteocytes are the main choreographers of remodeling process. Hyperparathyroidism and bone disease, I'm sure all the participants are experts in this. It is like carrying coal to the Newcastle. I won't go into the details of this, except that there are a lot of liver molecules which are coming into play, especially FGF23, which has a role in bone and also cardiac and cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. CKD and MPD is a clinical syndrome which develops due to the various systemic disorder of CKD and associated with bone abnormal metabolism and extraskeletal calcification. The complications start very early CKD stage, usually stage 3 and beyond, and increases with worsening renal function. In practice, though a bone biopsy is ideal, most of us will not be able to do a bone biopsy. And even if you are able to do a bone biopsy, we don't have anybody who can interpret a bone biopsy appropriately and help us in our clinical guide. So most often we rely on surrogate markers like PTH, calcium, phosphorus, and if available, bone-specific alkaline phosphorus. Classification of a renal bone disease, as you are all aware, one is mainly osteogenesis fibrosis, which all of us are aware about. Adynamic bone disease, which is increasing in the recent times. Osteomalacia is less seen in CKD patients, and there can be a mixed uremic osteodysport. This is the pathogenesis and pathophysiology. Starts with adynamic bone disease, which can be a variation between normal to osteogenesis fibrosa, and depending on what interventions we do, the bone may go either towards adynamic bone disease or towards osteogenesis fibrosis. Basically, secondary hyperparathyroidism leads to osteofibrosis because of one is phosphate retention, decreased free available calcium, and decreased calcitriol. Usually, it starts when the GFR drops to less than 40 ml and becomes more significant once the GFR becomes less than 40 ml. This again the pathophysiology, basically hyperphosphatemia and hyperparathyroidism, which leads to the bone disease. Adynamic bone disease has been increasing in the recent times. One is with the treatment and intervention by various physicians and the ground level. The minute somebody sees creatinine up for 2-3, they start them on calcium, vitamin D, including diuretics and things like that, which may worsen the bone disease and suppress CTH unnecessarily, leading to adynamic bone disease, which is more worse. We don't need a treatment for adynamic bone disease. Main risk factor for adynamic bone disease is elderly age group, diabetes, aluminium, which is now banned for most of the bone tea, and excessive usage of vitamin D are mainly the risk factors for adynamic bone disease. This is the bone histology, bone biopsy, the histology on the left side, and the right one is the tetracycline labeled stains. It's a normal bone. Normally we don't see these pictures because we don't get to do a biopsy and we don't have people to read. This is osteogenesis fibrosis cystica to show increased resorption and increased osteoclastic activity. This is adynamic bone, which is where you can see you need to search for the bone. Bone is very, very reduced in, the bone formation is reduced and bone resorption also can be seen. This is mixed where you see both bone being adynamic and also in places where you can see osteogenesis fibrosis cystica as well. Osteomalacia not much seen, it can happen due to aluminum. In hemodialysis patients, most commonly we see actually, as of now, if you look at statistics, we see equally osteogenesis fibrosis cystica and adynamic bone disease. Adynamic bone disease is more in peritoneal dialysis patients. This is the graph to show where adynamic bone disease is increasing and osteogenesis fibrosis cystica is stayed the same. 2017 guidelines were the latest guidelines on CKD and mineral bone disease. I will only go through the highlights of that. Basically, what the 2017 guidelines and the even current guidelines say is not a single value is important to guide the therapy. Don't go by single value of calcium, phosphorus or a PTH. The trend is more important. Don't go by a single one. So that's the reason we need to have a serial monitoring depending on what stage of the CKD they have and what is abnormalities you find it. Anybody with vitamin D deficiency and insufficiency definitely can be corrected, but try to prevent excessive vitamin D usage. There is a definite deficiency, there is a merit in giving vitamin D. Since there is a lot of evidence to show that there is osteoporosis in CKD MPD, compared to the previous 2009 guidelines where they said BMD is not routinely needed. 2017, they revised guidelines saying BMD can be performed, especially people who are at risk of developing fractures, which will help us in taking a treatment decision and it may have impact in preventing fractures. So multiple new studies have documented that low dose BMD definitely helps us in guiding the treatment and preventing incidental fractures. In children especially, we need to monitor their linear growth. We should not forget about growth and we should also monitor regularly once in quarter or at least annually. Vascular calcification, all of those are aware. What are the treatment targets? Again, as I mentioned, the treatment target should be based on a serial measurements of calcium, phosphorus, PTH and if available bone alkaline phosphatase. Avoid hypercalcemia, try to avoid too much of calcium supplementation. In children, it may be appropriate to maintain serum calcium at age appropriate normal range. This is the rationale for the update on hypercalcemia avoidance in children. Of course, calcium should be maintained at a specific level in the dialysate, again to prevent adynamic bone disease. And phosphate lowering agents also, we should try to reduce the or restrict the usage of calcium based phosphate binders. This again to prevent adynamic bone disease. This was a little different from 2009 guidelines. You need to restrict calcium and phosphate binders and try to avoid too much of vitamin D. Only in children probably it is allowed. This is to show the more usage of non-calcium based binders have an advantage both on mineral bone disease and also cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. And all of us should also ensure that the dialysis phosphate is removed appropriately. Dialysis is insufficient, no point in giving excessive phosphate binders and keeping dialysis going. Try to remove as much as possible phosphorus in the dialysis.
Hello. Sorry to interrupt you, sir, but can you please remove your headphone because we are not getting the voice properly, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Very well, sir. Please.
Okay. Sorry. So I thought headphones would be better. Sorry. So we need to definitely look at modifiable factors like hyperphosphatemia, hypocalcemia, and whether phosphorus intake is high and if anybody is deficient in vitamin D. So this is again the work group felt that we should always have a look at modifiable factors, not only a one value of PTH before taking any decision on PTH management. This is again a little different from 2009 guidelines. They have again said not to use too much of vitamin D analogs and also reserve use of calcitriol in only people who have severe and progressive hyperparathyroidism. This is again to prevent adynamic bone disease. This was based on two trials like PRIMO and OPERA, where they found there was increased risk of hypercalcemia with paracalcitol and other calcium vitamin D supplements. That's the reason they have moved away from too much of vitamin D analogs and vitamin D. Calcimimetics, there was a trial called EVOLVE trial where they found that there is no difference between calcium mimetics and other group of drugs. So that's the reason whenever we try to suppress PTH, it should be done with a combination of probably calcium mimetics, calcitriol and vitamin D analogs, which are more helpful rather than only calcium mimetic. This is the one which was based on EVOLVE trial. Since it didn't meet its primary endpoints, calcium mimetic should not be the only drug for controlling the PTH. This is the EVOLVE trial, which didn't show much of difference. There is no current recommendation to use cinacalcet in pediatric age group. There are a lot of other trials which are going on, which may be available by the end of this year or probably next year. In severe hyperparathyroidism, definitely if they are not getting controlled with pharmacological therapy, consider parathyroidectomy. So what is the current standing on bisphosphonates and osteoporotic management? This is again, it was different from a previous 2009 guideline where they said don't use BMD. Now we can always use DEXA, and depending on the risk of the patient, we can consider anti-resorptive therapies. This again to reduce fractures. And as we all know, bone biopsy is not easily available to everyone. So bone biopsy is not a must before we consider anti-resorptive therapies or osteoporotic therapies in dialysis population. If there is no evidence of any adynamic bone disease, definitely we can consider anti-resorptive therapies in dialysis population also, and also especially in CKD stage 3 and stage 4. To simplify, if there is no evidence of CKD MBD, anti-resorptive osteoporotic agent can be considered. If there is evidence of CKD MBD in GFR 15 to 30 around and also less than 15, anti-resorptive drug should not be administered. Transplant is some complete different topic by itself. I won't go into the transplant and bone disease. A few words about what are the various papers presented in ERADTA. This is a paper which spoke about renal osteodystrophy and peritoneal dialysis. As we are all aware, in fact, they have done bone biopsies in this population. Again, adynamic bone disease was much higher in this population, showing that low bone turnover disease was much higher in peritoneal dialysis population. Of course, this was proven by bone biopsy. This was a newer modality of testing for bone classification short of a biopsy, something similar to PET, where they did scan of all the dialysis patients and they found good sensitivity in patients with CKD. This was a basically sodium fluoride PET scan. Probably it may be available in future for all of us. It may help us in guiding the treatment since we can't do bone biopsy in our patients. So they concluded it is a definite diagnostic tool in evaluating dialysis patients for ROD. This was again a paper which spoke about iron related sucroferric oxyhydroxide, which has been used as a phosphate binder. It was called as Euclid analysis, where they found sucroferric oxyhydroxide, which is a chewable tablet, had a good phosphate binding capacity, and in fact it reduced phosphorus levels. And if you look at their chart, even pill burden came down because phosphate binders were less. It did the both functions of giving iron supplements and also reducing the phosphorus. Ferritin levels also were well maintained with the sucrophoric oxyhydroxide, and hemoglobin concentrations were marginally better. IV iron usage came down, hence reducing the iron toxicity, and USA usage also was marginally better. So only problem with the study was limitations where there was no active control arm, and it was a retrospective study which was taken out from the chart. So they also looked at more than 1,000 European hemodialysis patients, where they found with this phosphorus an increase in ferritin levels. To conclude my talk, there are a lot of studies which are evaluating on the role of BMD in patients on dialysis, and it is also important that we consider a therapeutic decision based on a series of tests rather than a single test, especially on PTH and hyperphosphatemia. And we need to reduce too much of exposure of calcium based binders, calcium supplements in dialysis and CKD population. We should also look at hidden dietary phosphate intake, and also make sure that they are on good dialysis for phosphate removal. As of now, there is no consensus to recommend cinacalcet as a first line therapy for lowering PTH. Definitely, it can be considered in the armamentarium of treating hyperparathyroidism. I conclude here. I would like to thank again for the opportunity given. Maybe I will take the questions as sir mentioned after all the talks.
Thank you.